Can I ask y'all something? Is this true? Let's find out. Hey, good morning. It's Uncle Lou here. Yeah, that's right. It's me, Uncle Lou, and I'm live for you on YouTube today. Thanks for watching. I really appreciate it. Subscribe to the channel if you're not already. I post college football videos almost every single day of the year. And believe it or not, a handful of them here and there are almost watchable. So subscribe. I would appreciate it. Share this video with your friends. Leave a comment down below. Let me know all the different ways I'm wrong in this video and give it a thumbs up. I would appreciate it. We've done a couple of these videos already, right? I'm doing an entire series, best case, worst case. We're going through a series of teams, highlighting some teams here, and trying to figure out what's the best case scenario and what's the worst case scenario in terms of regular season record for this series of teams, right? So not getting into anything too specific here in terms of wins and losses on the schedule as far as who teams would beat or lose to, but trying to come up with sort of a spread, right? If everything goes right, I could see this team winning this many games. If everything goes wrong, maybe they lose this many games. That's sort of the general idea. And of course, every summer, starting about halfway through June, I do a detailed in-depth preview and prediction video for 40, 50, 60 teams where we go through all those schedules game by game, and I pick a winner for every single game on the schedule. We'll still be doing that over the summer. This is just sort of an earlier, scaled down version of that. And of course, up today, the Texas Longhorns. All right, of course, everybody's familiar with that clip I played at the beginning of the video. That's Texas quarterback Sam Ellinger following Texas's Sugar Bowl victory over my Georgia Bulldogs in a New Year's Six Bowl, Sugar Bowl from this past season. Probably the biggest win Texas has had in close to a decade, really. Now, they did beat Oklahoma in the regular season this past year, and that's a huge rivalry game. So anytime Texas beats Oklahoma, that's a huge win. But in terms of sort of overall or maybe program defining or program shifting wins, that Sugar Bowl win was a pretty big win for Texas. Was I surprised Texas was that good last year? No. To be honest, if it wasn't for the fact that Georgia was the team that Texas ended up beating in the Sugar Bowl, I would have spent the last 2 months bragging and telling everybody how right I've been about Texas, right? I've been really high on Texas for the last two seasons, 17 and 18. Now, in 17, turned out I was a year ahead of the curve, but last year, I ended up being pretty close to accurate on my thoughts on Texas heading into last season. Now, they came out, of course, lost to Maryland first game last year for the second year in a row, and it looked like Uncle Lou was going to be an idiot again. But you guys turned it around, big win over Oklahoma in the regular season before losing in the rematch against Oklahoma in the Big 12 title game. But you did get a big win against Georgia in the Sugar Bowl, so a really good season for Texas. 10-4, win over Georgia in the Sugar Bowl, right? Went over Oklahoma in the regular season. So a great season by any standard, really. Now, is that where Texas wants to be? No, Texas wants to get back to winning the Big 12, making some college football playoffs, competing for national titles, and they have hopes of doing that this year. I released my way too early post-national signing day top 10 poll a couple of weeks ago, and I had Texas at number 10 in that poll. And I'm going to be honest with you, Texas fans, after spending a little bit of time yesterday and about an hour this morning looking into Texas some more, 10 may be too low for Texas. Texas could be poised to have a really, really big year in 2019. This may end up being the third year in a row Uncle Lou is really, really high on Texas heading into the season. We'll see as the next couple of months go by. We got spring practice starting. We'll see how things shake up after that. I'll be doing another top 10 poll after the spring games are played. But I can tell you right now, if I was going to make another poll today, Texas would be higher than 10. But I'll have a poll coming out after the spring games. All right, we're going to put the schedule up in a minute and sort of look at that. But before we get there, let's just talk about Texas in general. Okay, it starts with Tom Herman, right? This will be his third year in Austin, is that right? Yeah, Texas very excited about this guy. Known as an offensive mind. Texas defense carried him really in Tom Herman's first year. And at times last year, the offense did come around and look pretty good at times last year. But in my mind, Texas has only scratched the surface in terms of offensive potential under Tom Herman. That's not a knock on Texas. If anything, that's a compliment. I think Texas's offense in 2019 could be the best it's been in 10 years. I think Texas has potential to have a really good offense this year. If they can keep their defense anywhere near the same level that it's been over the last 2 years, I think Texas can be a big problem in the Big 12 in 2019. Of course, you get quarterback Sam Ehlinger back. He'll be a junior, so a third-year starter here. 3,300 yards last year through the air with 25 touchdowns. Added another 500 on the ground and 16 touchdowns. And really destroyed my Georgia Bulldogs with his legs in particular in that Sugar Bowl. He had two or three rushing touchdowns in that Sugar Bowl against Georgia. One of the toughest players that I've seen in college football, and I watch a lot of college football. I'm no Texas fan, but I have no hate for Texas either. I know leading up to the Sugar Bowl, of course, there was a series of videos I made, but if you guys have been around the channel for a while, you sort of know how this works. And if you've been around for a long time, then you know I've been really high on Texas over the last couple of years. So the Sugar Bowl trash talk, that's exactly what it was just trash talk. Ehlinger, a pretty good quarterback. He's accurate. I think he completed 70% of his passes in that Sugar Bowl. And I mentioned the touchdowns he had on the ground. And super tough. Georgia last year, not a great job of getting after the quarterback over the course of the season. They had a couple of games where they played really well, but in general didn't do a very good job of getting to the quarterback. But in that Texas game, we got a lot of pressure on Sam Ehlinger. We got to him in the backfield a lot of times. We just couldn't bring the guy down. I hesitate to compare anybody to Tim Tebow. As much as I hate Florida, Tim Tebow widely considered to be probably one of the top 5 or 10 college football players of all time. And he was notoriously hard to bring down. And Sam Ehlinger, watching Georgia play in that Sugar Bowl against Texas, Ehlinger reminds me of a Tebow type of player. I'm not convinced that Ehlinger has an elite world-class arm. Now, he can throw the ball. He can get the job done. But I don't think anybody would say Ehlinger is one of the best 5 passing quarterbacks in college football. But when you combine that, his passing ability, with what he's able to do on the ground with his legs, his toughness, his ability to break tackles, he's not afraid of contact. You combine those things, you got yourself a pretty good quarterback at Texas. For at least this coming up season and maybe 2 more seasons, depending on whether or not he decides to go pro early or not. So no questions at Texas on the with the quarterback position. The question marks with Texas on offense to me heading into 2019 is going to be offensive line and running back. And really those two things sort of go hand in hand. I think Texas has some pretty good running backs. I think they've been held back a little bit by the offensive line. I have not been overly impressed with Texas's offensive line last year or the year before. And this year, 2019, they're breaking in up to 4 new starters on that offensive line. They got one guy coming back that's entrenched as a starter for sure, but you could see 4 new faces on Texas offensive line. I think Texas needs to take a step forward in the run blocking department, which I think would create extra opportunities for those running backs. Now, you had a kid last year, he's a freshman, and what was his name? Keontae Ingram. Ran for 700 yards. So this kid's got talent. If Texas offensive line can improve a little bit this year with the run blocking, he could go for 1,000 yards. If you can get a running back that teams have to respect to go along with what Ehlinger can do with his legs, and you guys have got some good wide receivers, Texas's offense could be legit. Oklahoma has been sort of the baseline in terms of offensive production for the Big 12 over the last few years. And while I don't expect Texas to put up Oklahoma-like numbers over the course of an entire season, Texas's offense could find itself in a position in 2019 where they can compete and win some shootouts if they need to. A lot is going to depend, I think, on that offensive line and how well it comes together and how early it comes together. Cohesion and, it, you know, familiarity, whatever that word is, on the offensive line is huge. Guys like to be familiar. Let's do that. It'd be easier for me to say. With who's playing on their left and on their right. So we could see the offensive line really improve over the course of the season for Texas as that offensive line gets used to playing with one another. Now, defense is, I'm worried about Texas's defense, sort of. You lose eight starters. Texas has had the best defense in the Big 12 over the last couple of years. This defensive coordinator you guys have, Todd Orlando, I think his name is, you're paying him an obscene amount of money, and I don't blame you. This guy has done an amazing job with Texas defense over the last few years. No one would dispute that. An elite secondary, an elite back end. You hear a lot of people talk about Florida and LSU when they talk about defensive backs. Texas may have the best group of defensive backs in America in 2019, and they are really, really young back there, too. Of course, led by, what's his name? I don't think I wrote it down. I should have wrote it down. Anyway, you guys will know who I'm talking about. Caden Stearns. That's who it is, Caden Stearns. This guy, potential All-American. He was a freshman last year. Could be an All-American guy this year. But your secondary is absolutely loaded, even though it's young. It's very, very talented. Now, you do have some question marks. Linebacker, you're going to have to find some pieces there. You brought a JUCO transfer in. Wouldn't surprise me to see him get the start or at least a lot of playing time. But replacing eight starters off that defense not going to be easy to do. But like I said, if there's a defensive coordinator in the Big 12 who I trust, it would be Todd Orlando. If you gave me pick of any defensive coordinator in the Big 12, that's who I would take. Even though you lose eight starters, and I think it's a sort of a question mark heading into 2019. Todd Orlando has not given you any reason not to trust him over the last few years. And yes, you lose eight starters, but if you look at the recruiting that Texas has done, Texas has seemed to go under the radar for some reason in terms of recruiting rankings. Now, I know Texas fans are going to be familiar with the great recruiting classes they've had over the last few years, but as a general college football fan who deals with a lot of college football fans from a lot of different fan bases from all over the country, I can tell you right now, not a lot of people talk about Texas and their recruiting classes when they talk about elite recruiting classes. You hear a lot of talk about Alabama, Georgia. Even Texas A&M got a lot of press this year with their recruiting class. Well, Texas finished ahead of Texas A&M. Let's just look at the recruiting classes that Texas has put together. And we'll just do the last 4 years because that's going to be the team that Texas puts on the field this year, 4 years worth of recruiting classes. Third, 25th. And seventh. That's a great four-year stretch in terms of recruiting. Compare that to what most people would consider, for obvious reasons, the best team in the Big 12 over the last 4 years, Oklahoma. 6, 9, 8, and 19. You have out-recruited Oklahoma consistently over the last 4 years. There's only been 1 year where they had a higher recruiting ranking than Texas. That was three seasons ago when Texas was 25th. That was Strong's last year. And Oklahoma was eighth. Now, Oklahoma, no slouch here, 6, 9, 8, and 19. Those are great recruiting classes. But Texas, 3, 3, 25, and 7. Texas, listen to me. Listen to this, Oklahoma fan. Texas, right now, is more talented than Oklahoma. I mean, that's just the reality of the situation. Now, does that mean Oklahoma is going to lose to Texas this year necessarily? No, but top to bottom, Texas has the most talented roster in the Big 12 in my mind. You got to get the offensive line figured out. You got to do something about your linebackers on defense, and you got to find some playmakers over there after losing eight starters from last year. But with Ehlinger coming back, big things in 2019. All right, so here we go. We're going to throw the schedule up on the screen here, and we're going to do this the same way we did it for the other teams. So run through the schedule real quick, and then we'll break it into a couple of different parts. We're going to talk about your non-conference schedule. We'll talk about any tough away games you might have. I always like to try to find the toughest three-game stretch on someone's schedule, and then we'll see if there's any potential trap games on this schedule too. Brief thoughts about this schedule here. Here it is. If you don't go, if you don't win at anything worse than 10-2 with this schedule, and you're the worst team in America, Texas. This schedule, if you're in the Big 12, you couldn't hand pick a better schedule than this. I mean, this sets up. Anyway, all right. Well, let's just get into. You leave the state of Texas twice all year. All year you leave the state of Texas twice, but let's just run through it. Week one, you open up at home, Louisiana Tech. Who is that? No one knows. Week two, huge game, LSU, but you get them at home. Now, this is going to be a great game here. I don't know which way Vegas is going to lean on this game, but at this point, I'm going to be honest with you. With it being a home game for Texas and the way you guys ended and the recruiting you've been doing and who you've got coming back, it would not surprise me at all to see Texas head into this LSU game as a 2-3-4-point favorite. It would not surprise me at all. This is going to be a hell of a game here. This is one of the biggest non-con games of the season. This one, a lot of people, of course, talking about Florida and Miami, but this is going to be a huge game here, LSU. Week three, Rice, neutral site game, okay? So your first three games, non-con, all in the state of Texas. All right, week four, you open up your Big 12 schedule, but guess what? It's at home against Oklahoma State. So your first four games, all in the state of Texas. Then you get a bye week. Coming out of your bye week, uh-oh, rare road game, rare trip out of the state of Texas. You got to go all the way to Morgantown and play at West Virginia. They lose Will Greer, a couple of NFL wide receivers, new coaching staff. I expect West Virginia to take a pretty big step back this year. You would think right now Texas would be a big favorite in this game. All right, moving on. Oklahoma, neutral site game, biggest regular season game of the year, every single year for Texas. One of the biggest rivalries in all of college football. And no surprise to you, Shorthorn, this game's played where? In the state of Texas, in Dallas. So here we are halfway through the season. You've left the state of Texas one time. All right, follow that up with a home game against Kansas. So just to be clear here, Louisiana Tech, LSU, Rice, Oklahoma State, West Virginia, Oklahoma, Kansas. And you leave the state of Texas one time during that stretch of games. Kansas, new coach, Les Miles, but the talent just isn't there. Now, the talent wasn't there a couple of years ago when they beat you, but still, they beat you. So we'll see. But no one expects Kansas to be able to compete with Texas this year, okay? Now you get another road game, but guess what? It's at TCU. What's TCU stand for? Texas Christian University, which tells me it must be in the state of Texas. So here we are. What is this, eight games? So, yeah, your first eight games, you've left the state of Texas one time. Now you get another bye week. Home game against Kansas State. They're breaking in a new coaching staff. Red alert. On the road, out of the state of Texas, at Iowa State. You can't win there. And by you, I don't mean Texas specifically. I mean anybody. There's some guy on YouTube, I can't even remember his name. He's an Oklahoma fan. He swears to God you can't win a game at Iowa State. He tells Uncle Lou and anyone else that'll listen or won't listen that Iowa State is the toughest place in America to play. No one has been scared to play anything from the state of Iowa since Field of Dreams, okay? And Kevin Costner ain't running through the cornfield. This is friggin' Iowa State. I really wish these Big 12 people would shut the hell up about how hard it is to play a game at Iowa State, woo. Give me a friggin' break, man. You're embarrassing yourself. Back-to-back road games. After at Iowa State, you got another road game, but guess what? Baylor. Baylor's in the state of Texas. What else do we know about Baylor? Not much, other than the fact that they've won the Big 12 twice since the last time Texas did, but I digress. And then you finish up your regular season at home against Texas Tech, the Red Raiders. So there you go. 12 games. Twice you leave the state of Texas. Your bye weeks are spread evenly throughout the year, so play four games, bye week, play four games, bye week. And then you play your last four games. You do have two road games in a row at Iowa State and at Baylor, but Baylor's in your home state. Not much of a road game there, to be honest. You've got two neutral site games against Rice and Oklahoma. So, all right, here we go. We'll talk about your non-con. Louisiana Tech, LSU, and Rice. LSU, and now listen, these are two pretty evenly matched teams in my mind, Texas and LSU. This is a game that if I had to pick it right now, I would struggle to pick a winner on that one. I think it could go either way. But for the purposes of this video, which is a best case, worst case, you have to at least consider the possibility that LSU is capable of beating Texas. Not saying that will happen, but that's a possible loss. Louisiana Tech and Rice, you should run over them without a problem, I would think. Oklahoma State's not very good. The problem is, when is the last time Texas has beat Oklahoma State? I mean, you got to get in a DeLorean to figure out how long it's been since that happened. 2014? Really? Where's the flux capacitor? I don't know, but how have you lost to Oklahoma State 15, 16, 17, 18? 4 years in a row? Lost to Oklahoma State? Jesus Christ. The last time you beat Oklahoma State, Gundy or whatever his name is, was still 40. Now he's like 45 or something. You'll be favored in that game. It's at home, but they've had your number lately. Bye week. Excuse me in that. Let's look at your away games, okay? How many true away games do you have? Four. At West Virginia. I guess that's one of those games where you could say, well, maybe things could go sideways, but Texas is a much better team than West Virginia. At TCU, you're a much better team than TCU. At Iowa State, impossible to win there, even though you're a much better team. At Baylor, garbage can program. What's your toughest road game? It's got to be either West Virginia or Iowa State. Iowa State might be the third best team in the Big 12. Let me tell you something. The Big 12 is a pitiful conference this year. The Big 12 will be the worst conference in football in 2019. Yes, Texas and Oklahoma are legitimate top 10 teams. Everyone else is an absolute trash can in this entire league. So those are your only away games. Toughest three-game stretch. LSU, Rice, Oklahoma State. That's pretty tough considering you can't beat Oklahoma State and LSU is a top 10 team. West Virginia, Oklahoma, Kansas on the road at West Virginia. That could be a potential trap game. It's your first road game of the year. The furthest you can possibly travel in the Big 12, Texas to West Virginia. And it's the week before your biggest game of the year, Oklahoma. And you know, the most common type of trap game is, of course, a game played against an inferior opponent the week before your biggest game of the year. That's literally the textbook definition of a trap game. But is that really a tough stretch, West Virginia, Oklahoma, and Kansas? Yeah, Kansas is going to have an improvement in coach with Les Miles, but like I said, the talent's just not there. Kansas State, Iowa State, Baylor? That's not a tough three-game stretch. Iowa State, Baylor, Texas State. No, I mean, I guess the toughest three-game stretch is LSU, Rice, and Oklahoma State because you could potentially lose two of those games. Now, these aren't predictions. I'm not saying you're going to lose to LSU and Oklahoma State, but the potential is there to lose two of those three games, I think. So what does this look like? What do you guys think? What's the best case scenario here, Texas, in terms of wins? Now, obviously, it's March. Everyone's undefeated. Everyone could go 12-0. It's just really, really hard to go undefeated in college football. A couple of teams did it last year, but it's very rare and it's very hard to do. You don't see it that often to go 12-0. A lot of good teams go 11-1, 10-2, even 9-3 every single year. It's hard to get up week after week after week in big-time college football. I'm not sure if I'm willing to go as high as 12-0 as a best-case scenario here, especially when you consider the fact that Texas, especially over the last 4 or 5 years, just has a tendency to lose, hell, sometimes two or three games in a season that you look back at the end of the season and you go, how did Texas lose? You lost to Kansas a couple of years ago. You've lost to Oklahoma State how many years in a row? You lost to Maryland the last 2 years, right? I mean, you lost to Texas Tech and TCU a couple of years ago. These are all losses that at the end of the season, when you looked back, you said, how'd that happen? Texas is clearly better than that team. So, again, that's not a knock on Texas. You could say that same thing for almost every single team in America. You look back and how'd you lose that game? But anyway, the point is, it's just hard to go 12. But I'm going to be honest. You could go 11-1 here, very realistically, I think, 11-1. This schedule sets up unbelievable. You leave the state twice. Your bye weeks are spread out here. Four games bye week, four games bye week, then your last four games. Your only back-to-back road games are Iowa State and Baylor, one of those games being in your home state. You got two neutral site games that are both in the state of Texas. The Big 12 is down this year in my mind. I don't expect Oklahoma State to be a top 10 or 15 team. I don't expect West Virginia to be a top 10 or 15 team. I think Oklahoma and Texas are the only two really, really good teams in the Big 12. You should be able to run through the majority of this schedule. So best case scenario, I think 11-1 is possible. Now, worst case scenario, let's say you lose week two to LSU. Let's say by some miracle, Oklahoma State keeps the win streak against you going and you drop that one. West Virginia sneaks up on you the week before the Red River shootout. I mean, that would be three losses before you even played Oklahoma. Again, these are not things I expect to happen. Right now, we're talking about worst case scenario. Obviously, Oklahoma would be a potential loss. I mean, you could be sitting at 2-4. I don't expect that to happen. Kansas should probably beat them. TCU should beat them. Kansas State should beat them. At Iowa State, guess that's potential for a loss there. So that would be 5. 6-6, I just don't see that happening. You're just too loaded. 7-5 is the – and Texas is not going 7-5, but I do think that would be the floor. I can't see any way possible. I can't see any way possible you lose more than 5 games. And I don't expect you to lose 5. Again, there's going to be a lot of crying in the comments section because people don't listen to these whole videos and they don't understand what I'm saying. And all they're going to hear is me say 7-5, and their fingers are going to tense up and they're going like a drunk monkey typing on their phone or their keyboard or their typewriter, whatever, hooked up to a modem, whatever they're using out there in Texas these days to communicate via the interwebs. But anyway, I'm going to go with best case scenario for Texas in 2019, 11-1 in a return trip to the Big 12 title game. Worst case scenario, wheels fall off. Maybe you get some injuries, whatever. 7-5. I don't see any way possible. Listen, half your team could get injured. And in my mind, you would still go 7-5. So I just don't see it getting any worse than that. No way, no how. So that's what I'm going to go with, 7-5 to 11-1. I'm sure I'll do a preview and prediction video on Texas over the summer where I'll give you an exact record. So I'll come down somewhere. I'll name a winner and loser for all those games, and we'll see where I'm at then. But anyway, that's it for today. Have a great day and an even better morning if you can.